It ain't gonna happen. No, no, thank you, ladies. 308, God bless you, Sam, and thank you, able to resolve. Trustee, that's the Thursday night scene. Sounds like magic here. We got 25 people here, we can pull up here. Bless your heart. Now, we have our own singing. No discredit to this race, and we have our own singing. You got God on you. I love worshiping with you. Esther tonight, Book of Esther. The Book of Esther. Thank you. The Book of Esther tonight, I'm trying to be low. I want to share a few things with you tonight. I was so impressed to go to the Book of Esther this week. You know, Esther, chapter 8, verse 9, I think is the longest verse in the Bible. And oftentimes when your body's tired, I'll be honest with you, I don't try to find the longest chapters to read when I'm tired, do you? How many times you read Psalm 117? You really stretched it when you did Psalm 23. John 11, 35. 1st, 2nd Thessalonians 4:17, rejoice evermore, pray without ceasing. I'm going to the whole chapter there. But Esther tonight in her Bible, Esther, as we're standing together, I'll give you just a little background of history here. There's a king named King Ahasuerus who had a queen named Vashti. And Vashti, or Vashti, the king had ordered celebration. He was his made himself merry, and he asked Queen Vashti to come and present herself, and she said, "I ain't coming." So he said, "All right, then we got to do something about that." Said, and he was talking to the Persians and the Medes, everybody. King Ahasuerus ruled 123 provinces from India, you know what that is? India to North Africa. This king was in charge of 123 provinces. King Ahasuerus was, had a queen named Vashti or Vashti. Well, she wouldn't come and honor his and be obedient to him, so the Medes and Persians, you know, kings, if you can't have this, a woman ain't listening to the husband, so therefore we got to do something with her. So what they did, they demoted her, and the king put out a decree for all the young virgin available ladies come in there, and they housed them in the queen's house. Now back then, the queen lived in the house, and he lived in the house. Can you imagine that? That's where the doghouse comes from, I reckon. So they was out there, and so they went over to the house, the women's house, and all the virgins come in, the pure young girls come in there, and Mordecai was one of the servants of Ahasuerus. He was one of the servants, and you'll find him always at the sitting at the king's gate. You will find sometimes Mordecai, you must realize in your life, and I'll be making application to him in a moment, but Mordecai, technically, I cannot read over one time, maybe one time, that he even got close to coming inside. He just sat at the gate. But yet he was one of the greatest biblical characters, and he said this, and get this, Mordecai had an uncle, a brother, that had a daughter named Esther. And Mordecai's daddy had died, and so Esther would actually be Mordecai's cousin. But after his daddy died, and then her dad died, he took over and fathered her, his cousin, as one of his children. Evidently, he's much older. And so therefore, when the decree went out that they needed somebody, a possible queen, to rule and reign, Mordecai said, I know just the girl. Sitting outside the gate, man. you don't get to go in. Mordecai said, I believe I know just the girl. Come a recommendation. But now get this, Mordecai was a Jew, and King Ahasuerus was not a Jew. He was like an Ammonite, or a Malachite, an Ammonite. He was one of the Ishmaelite side. He wasn't a good guy. But yet, King Ahasuerus still, got to get this, he still had some morals while he reigned. Someone said this here, well, I don't want Donald Trump to be president. Well, God knows I don't want Hillary. Mm-hmm. I'd rather have Jimmy Carter's brother be the president than Hillary. Billy Carter, I'd rather him sell Billy Beer. In the White House and have Hillary.
Oh, yes.
I'm telling you, God's honest truth. But we don't need Trump. Listen, I'm voting for the lesser of two evils. And mind you, I'm not voting on a pastor. I'm voting on a president.
Right.
Remember that. You must remember that. Mm-hmm. We're not voting a pastor into whatever. We're voting a president.
Right. Yeah.
We're voting leadership. Something to get us out of this godforsaken mess we're in.
Yeah.
That's right.
Amen. Hey, all right, let me say this. Rather someone to lead us, because I don't think we're going to get out of the mess we're in, but rather someone that will at least aim us in the right direction, though we may not hit the mark.
Right.
But anyway, Mordecai, mind you, was sitting at the gate, and Mordecai was a Jew. He was working in that wicked reign of the Ammonites and Ahasuerus and fasting. And he said, I know this girl might be a good queen. Said, who was that? Said, her name is Esther. My cousin, I've been raised her since she's a little girl. And Esther was a Jew. Now, I'm telling you, business is about to pick up, you know. The Lord is not slack concerning his promises, and some men count slackness.
Right.
And the Lord is still in control. But with that said, there the king said, okay, send her in. I'd like to talk to her. And then one by one, they sent each virgin lady into the king there, and he talked with them there, and told him what he wanted, the queen and the wife and all that. And make a long story short, he said, Mordecai, that's the woman. Mordecai, can I say this? Be honest in your mind. If God shows you his will for something, you don't have to run all around the world trying to make something else happen.
Right.
If God shows you what it needs to be, then go out. So quit chasing your dreams and see what God's got for you. See what God's got. Well, that said, looking here in Esther, in our Bibles, I want to read to you. In verse number 11 of chapter 2. Matter of fact, verse number 10 of chapter 2, Esther had not yet told King Ahasuerus she was a Jew. Nor had Mordecai, and Esther hadn't told all the other virgin girls there she was a Jew either. So she kind of got slipped in on something big. He said, wait, what did you guys say? I didn't know I was getting all this. And now my name on the sign. I'm driving a better car than I ever had in my life. I'm eating better food than ever, and y'all good to me. And you know what? You've been blessed to God.
Amen.
You've got more than we deserve.
Amen.
So true.
We don't deserve anything.
You're right.
We just come in the middle of something big. And we didn't have to poor mouth how bad it was to try to get somebody to feel sorry for us, to give us nothing to pay the power bill. When I got saved, I got in the middle of something big. Verse 10 of chapter 2, Esther had not shown her people nor her kindred, for Mordecai had charged her that she should not shew it or show it. And Mordecai walked every day before the court of the women's house to know how Esther did and what should become of her. Now with that, let's turn over to chapter, I believe, number 5 there. In verse number 14, then said Zeresh, that's Haman's wife, and this man named Haman's going to come in the picture. A man named Haman was promoted in chapter 3 there as to be a chief advisor. He was advanced up in Ahasuerus' reign there, and he said, pretty much, you in charge of everything. Just kind of keep me informed, and you can make a decision you want to, Haman. But I found out Haman was a devil. He was a devil. And look at verse number 14 of chapter 5. Then said Zeresh, his wife, and all his friends unto him, let a gallows be made of 50 cubits high, and tomorrow speak down the king that Mordecai may be hanged thereon. He got jealous toward Mordecai. Because Mordecai, I'm giving the history, and this is our text. Mordecai, when Haman stood up, everybody bowed down and worshiped Haman. Mordecai didn't bow down. I ain't worshiping that fool. He's of the devil. And he said this, so Haman had a gallows built 50 cubits high, 50 foot high, whatever that, there. And he said this, he said, tomorrow, at this time, we're going to hang Mordecai. And the thing pleased Haman, and he caused the gallows to be made. And then he goes on here. Guess what happened? Esther and Mordecai began to pray. She said, Mordecai, I'm going to go into the king and intervene. And said, it's customary if someone walks into the king's court, that if they are accepted and he has mercy on them, he will reach his scepter out, hold it over the hand, and you touch the scepter means you're at liberty to speak and have mercy on them. But if he doesn't put his scepter out, that means no key. So Esther said, but are you praying for Mordecai? And Mordecai, they were sending letters back and forth, and listen, Esther, you got to do something. She said, I know Mordecai. Said, you tell you what, you fast and pray for me, and we'll fast and pray over here in the women's house. They all started fasting and praying. And then Esther had enough strength and power of God. She went into the king and bowed down and said, oh, king. The king touched her, he touched the scepter, and said, okay, you speak your mind. She said, king, I was just thinking about something. Said, Lord, I'm giving you a history of 19 chapters of Esther and fireball over here. And said that somebody been bothering me, king. Said, well, what are you doing? He said, well, I want to make a supper. I want you, king, I want you to come, and I want Haman to come. Haman, isn't it? And Haman said, boy, that's a living, man. This is a living. So in the meantime, Ahasuerus had a dream, and God spoke to his heart, and he got to thinking about a man named Mordecai. He said, you know, that Mordecai was the one that saved my life when these two other, Beelzebub and another guy, rose up going to kill the king. So Mordecai put a stop to him and told him, said, these people are trying to kill you. So the king got rid of the two devils and trying to kill him. And Mordecai never was rewarded for his service. Wasn't nothing said about it. And it's amazing, Mordecai been praying, Esther and the virgin have been praying, Haman's been made a gallows, was going to hang Mordecai because the angelic of Mordecai wouldn't bow down to Haman. And so Esther praying, Mordecai praying, and then she went in, the king had mercy on her and said, by the way, I want to say one thing. So the king said, you can have everything up to half of the kingdom. Esther, what do you want, queen? Said this. He said, I just want to have a meeting with you and Haman tomorrow, king. I'm going to fix dinner for you. So when it said fix dinner for him, guess what happened? He went back there, guess what happened? And then you'll find out that again, they've been praying. About that time, the king forgot that Mordecai hadn't been rewarded. So when he went to dinner, he said to Haman, he was his advisor. So Haman said, what do you think ought to be done to a man that's valiant and right and good and honorable? And Haman thought because God had advanced him, he was talking about him. He said, I tell you what I think. I think you ought to give him a big white king's horse. You ought to give him the king's robe. He said, okay, okay. And he said, you ought to give him a chariot to ride in. Yeah, yeah, that's good, that's good. And praise the Lord. And all this. And then King Ahasuerus said, okay, Haman, go get Mordecai. That's what I'm going to give him. Things had to begin to heat up. As they say, it's young, it's getting on. It's getting on. So, now, at this time, Haman didn't know that Esther was going to fix him some supper. He didn't understand all that, so he told Zeresh, I said, they invited me. And then Ahasuerus to go. And his wife, and said, but then the king's going to be nice to Mordecai and give him all that stuff. And Zeresh said, honey, you need to go anyway because the queen invited you. So he listened to his wife. He went in there, and he went in to have dinner with King Ahasuerus. And Queen Esther, Haman, the wicked one, come in. And then she goes to say this, the king obeys him. So came to say anything, but I wanted the guilty one to be here when I brought this up. So this Haman has built a gallows 50 cubits high, and that good man that you are honoring tomorrow named Mordecai. You don't know him, but Haman had opened his heart, and Haman was going to hang him in the morning on that gallows. The king got upset. He walked outside and went out the yard. When he went out the door there, you'll find that Haman fell across the bed that Queen Esther was sitting on. There, when the king come back in, he thought he was trying to force himself on his wife. And then they're going to hit the fan big time. So guess what happened? I'm giving you this. Did you know Esther? They said, "Son, great God." And then he said it. Then he said it. Then Esther said it. Said the king, "This fool trying to kill Mordecai. He's against you the whole time." And guess what? Then King Ahasuerus said this. We're close to our text right here. King Ahasuerus said this. He said, "The same gallows that Haman had fixed for Mordecai, let him be hanged thereupon." And he hung him there from creep gun. Praise God, you may be seated tonight. I'm going to preach, I said all that today in this title. I'm going to preach on this thought, how to hang the Haman that's about to hang you. How to hang the Haman that's about to hang you. God, it took me all day long. God, give me that. How to hang the Haman that's about to hang you. He said, "Rick, what's trying to hang me?" I'll tell you what, hey, addiction trying to hang you. I'll tell you, we all have addiction. I can go right now, honest to God, and I can shoot an IV of Diet Mountain Dew in my veins if I don't get away from God. We all have addictions. Social addictions, social media addictions, texting addictions, talking addiction, gossip addiction, busybody addictions. Addictions are about to hang us. How to hang the Haman before it hangs you. Haman. Hey, and with that in mind, I thought about the game called Hangman. Hey, and notice, it is how to hang the Haman that's about to hang you. Now, in a traditional game of Hangman, you put little lines of ground, you're trying to guess the word, and there, if you don't get this throw, then don't look at all that yet. Just put the stick right down. I got more than 5 points, don't I? Well, I'm on the top part. Yeah, I got to put a program down. You can get it in a minute. Exactly, you wouldn't mind slipping up. But I'm saying, nigga, how to hang the Haman before he hangs you. Hey, every one of you and us have somebody that like to hang you. I tell you, this world like to hang you. Hey, your job like to hang you. You don't believe it? Slack off a little bit. Let some other young guy come in. He'll take your job, older person, and he can put you out on the breadline. Somebody trying to hang you. They're trying, because they can work them cheaper, work a part-time, not give any benefits, cut off your salary, cut off your insurance, cut off your retirement plan, put you out of the poorhouse, and put some goofball in there, and they'll still want you to tell the goofball how you trained, and probably the goofballs will take your place. People's out to hang you. How to hang the Haman before it hangs you. Most time in a hangman situation, pastor trying to guess a word, this slot trying to guess a word. A word. There you go. Word. There you go. Huh? And I said, "Is there a bee in that?" Man said, "No, ain't a bee in that." So he went on that thing and there like that. There's your head up there. And I said, "Matthew, is there a sea in that?" "No, ain't no sea in that." You don't know the word. You don't know what that is. I mean, but I wonder if that word is that. You don't see it. You get a little smiley face there, get the jaw and the head and neck on there and all that. Most of the time, you get hung for getting something wrong. But I tell you the God's truth in the Christian life, you'll get hung for doing right. You can have all the right answers. You can live the right life. You can be holy in prayer. You can take your heart and the heart of your family and put them on an altar and do right. And the pounds of hells of hell will try to hang you up to dry. And they'll cut off a relationship. They'll cut off a friendship. They'll throw you to the dogs. I'm saying, how to hang the Haman before it hangs you. And I believe God showed us some things in the scripture. Then you erase all that. Because now, what are we going to do? We're going to find some ways to hang before he hangs you. But there's some biblical ways we can hang the Haman before he hangs you. Know that in mind. Esther 2:11. Esther 2:11 read to you earlier. You get this, and you got to remember, this Jew named Mordecai, he is a picture of Jesus Christ. He's a picture of Christ. Hey, he's Richard Grimes. And I say part of the women's house to know how Esther did and what should become of her. Can I say that is a picture of Jesus Christ watching over us and caretaking us and caring about us. Every day, this Mordecai Jew that raised it, you know why he come up? Because he had a lot invested in her. Hey, when she was born, he took over caretaking. And when I was born again, God became my caretaker and takes care of me. And I want you to know every now and then, he's going to show up and check on me. Every day, go by there. I'm going to say, Esther, how's everything going? He's doing just fine, Mordecai. And this cord here is a picture of the house of God. Can I tell you, number one, if you want to hang a hangman before he hangs you, first thing you got to do, you must spend your life and dedicate your life and just simply say it like this, go to church. You want to hang a hangman, go to church. Put it in there, go to church. How to hang a hangman, go to church. Got that right, didn't you? You got that right tonight. How to hang a hangman, go to church. And guess what? They hang him. They go to that little bar across there now. Next time we'll go see him and hang him. We'll get his hand on our mom. But number two, Esther 3, verses 1 through 4. You got to go and read this, y'all. And you got to read it twice because you'll never get it the first time. Esther 3, verses 1 through 4. After these things, the king Ahasuerus promoted Haman, the son of Hammedatha, and the Agagite, and advanced him and set his seat above all the princes that were with him. And notice something here. Mordecai didn't get jealous about this and whine and pout about it. No, Mordecai just stayed faithful. Just, can I say this? When someone is advanced to a position that you would like to have and you feel like you deserve it, can I say to you, don't go getting jealous because you're going to end up hanging yourself. How to hang Haman before he hangs you. Notice this. He said this, and advanced him and set his seat above all the princes that were with him, and all the king's servants, verse 2, that were in the king's gate, bowed in reverence Haman, for the king had so commanded concerning him, but Mordecai bowed not, nor did in reverence. Then the king's servants, which were in the king's gate, said to Mordecai, why transgressest thou the king's commandment? Now it came to pass, when they spake daily unto him, and he hearkened unto them, that they told Haman to see whether Mordecai's matters would stand, for he had told them that he was a Jew. This whole issue is nothing to do with his position of servanthood. The position is he's a picture of Jew. He's a picture of morality. He's a picture of old-time values. And Haman hated for being that. Friend, can I say to you tonight, America and our leadership in America, we have a Haman in the White House that would like to hang you and I and Christian Bass out to dry. We have a Haman in the White House. Who's the answer? God's in control. Hey, God's in control, but there's different sects of leadership that are in control of their own precincts. And we have a Haman in the White House that would hang us and sold us out. I read 20 statements of negativity that he made about Christians. And I read 20 statements of positivity that he made about Muslims. God help us. I'm telling you, we're living in what Haman did, he kept sitting at the gate. He didn't bow down. He didn't hold back. He said, I tell you what, I'm not bowing. Listen to me. Well, we're to obey authority. We're to obey authority. I understand that. Until it comes to crossing my authority or my values and my service toward God, that draws the line. If it comes to living like hell and obeying authority or living for God and disobeying authority, I'm going to live for God. Because it's all said and done, the Haman that's hanging up everybody, he's going to be gone over with a few more days up there. And we'll get somebody different in there. God help Obama's Trump, not Hillary. Up and up, the whole thing find the Bible and the trump of God shall sound. What did that rhyme with Hillary was Hillary? I don't know. Or celery. But I'm saying then, I'm just going to vote for him because he ain't telling. But I'm not trying to politic to you. You can do what you want to as long as you do that. But I'm saying this, Angel. Hey, God's your father. He tell you what to do. Look at this. What he do? Every day, Haman was doing wicked stuff. Mordecai said this. Hey, number three, what do you do? Go to church. Number two, get this. Stay faithful, though it seems like the enemy's winning. But number three, get this. Number three, what do you do? He continued doing right when everybody else was doing wrong. He took a stand when no one had to stand with him. They said, bow down. He said, I ain't bowing to you. Remember this. Your service, what you're serving God, is to God. It's not to serve your family, serve yourself. Even serve the church, we're to serve the Lord.
Amen.
We come to serve the Lord now. No, we come to worship the Lord tonight. We go out tomorrow to serve the Lord.
Right.
We should be worshiping Jacob. Praise God.
Praising
God. Then go out there tomorrow and serve God. Got my hair cut today. This little lady was short, little. She's a big tall girl. She said, what do you do? I said, I'm pastor of a church. I said, I ain't worn haircuts. I'm more like a preacher than he is right now. I said, it gets all curly. And old women said, oh, you have the prettiest hair, pastor. I don't want no cougar after me.
Cougar.
Did I say that? That was a stroke, Bob. Blooper, cougar, blooper. Cougar, blooper. But I'm in the top, if you don't give us back the time. What do you do? Stay faithful. Just go to church. But notice this. I read this today. This said, and I hate trying to reach politics, but I tell you, politics has so invaded our religious laws and freedoms, we have to rebuke it and refute it. For us to be foolish. I just read this. You know, 6 out of 10 people polled in North Carolina are against the bathroom. Ain't your house bill too? 6 out of 2 of them are against house bill too. If that means correct, 6 out of 10, that means 60% of the people polled were perverts. God have America. God have North Carolina. Do you know this? Out of all the states, There's some states are considering a bill. There's others that's got rejected and turned down. North Carolina is the only state that signed the bill and stuck with God bless Pat McCrory. Yeah, I'm sure he'd done things crooked and wrong too. But thank God he had enough God-given sense to know what was right.
Amen.
Today we're not going to measure and knock something out because he messed something and did wrong. Today we're going to start measuring on what they did right. Because truth be known, we're all sinners and did something wrong. But ain't it good when it gets something right? Don't you get tired of saying, Johnny, you messed up again. You messed up again. You saw our kids, you messed up again. But ain't it good to say, thank you, did a great job. So you got to start putting praise on doing right. And they said this, and him and that paper were man, and that paper were I was in shock. I was running down the road. And Andrew Brock, I went to school with some of his family. Brock the Rock. What is it on that sign? Brock. Andrew Brock, he stands for Ron Beatty. And over there in the sand. You ever turn around? Free. Thank you. Brother Andrew Brock's a Christian. Some of our ladies plead for Andrew. Mom Miss Becky plead for Andrew Brock. Cindy. I went visiting other night and visit his wife was up, and his wife and baby's up there. I said, you know the baby Bronx? I said, I invite you to the church. Oh, I know your church, I preach it beautiful. I said, I appreciate your husband standing for right. But you know what happened? And I get this, the Haman we got in the White House, I guess I can call him Haman. If Trump called her crooked Hillary, I could call him Hanging Haman. Hussein Haman. I started treating. If I go to jail, bring some cigarettes. And you're smoking. Well, I thought we'd get something to kill time. Man, the girls, hang on. But I got something. I understand the prison we just sat on Fox News or not. The Haman that we got in the White House is wanting to go out with notoriety. He's going to go and change a bunch of things. You and I have not seen nothing yet. He's about to change at least 20. said, oh, we'll get a new president. You want Samuel? No. Understand, when it's signed by an executive order into law, it's going to stand. And you'll fight the devil. And you have a bunch of liberal justices. And like the thing we voted here about the marriage amendment, and then some hellish judge in Virginia overriding that, turning around, and we had a vote on it. With the will of people. That's right. Constitution about the will. That's what we set up. That's what we have. Hey, only thing they're adjusting it, it just enforce what we said. They're not to interpret. They just enforce what we did. Some editor, we know what it said. They just supposed to see us do. But the president, who's saying, hangman, in the White House. He is overriding all constitutional authority. He is overriding Congress and Senate and all those things. Now, I read this. They said today, I read this here. They said that when they voted on House Bill 2, the Senate of North Carolina won 32-0 in favor of House Bill 2. What? That's a majority? Because the other liberal Democrats walked out and wouldn't vote. So 32 conservatives voted against these messed up bathroom stuff, and then the liberals fought and said, we're not going to vote and show that we're opposed. And I suggest you vote them out come election time. Next Tuesday was a primary for congressmen. Andrew, you're going to go vote for Andrew next Tuesday on the 7th, Brock to Rock. Notice this. He sent on the back an executive order that all the congressmen got. This comes from my mailbox. And actually, Ruth Campbell, I don't know who Ruth is. There's 115 Hartman Lane, so I got somebody else's mail. I think it's a federal offense. I ain't gonna tell Ruth, she probably won't forget her. I'm all jacked up, the president and send me something. And it was to Ruth Campbell. He didn't even get the road right. And I've got some Campbell's Cross Road I can do it, they know the roots. So here, they sent this. This is President Obama sent this to the congressman. This is the executive order, the White House, May 3rd, 2016, directed on bathrooms. Dear school officials, you are ordered to remove all signage references gender for bathrooms and showers and replace it with the following. There's a half man, half woman sign. This is on the president's desk, sealed with the wax and it's sealed. I've been in the executive office building. And it said this, all gender. Said if you fail, and remind you, we're looking at a tyrant, so we're looking at this wicked Haman in the White House. If you fail to comply with this White House directive, we will direct the Justice Department to file suit and we'll cut off all funding from your school district. Friend, I'm telling you, simple communism, socialism, that's threatening and putting us under fear of the government. Hey, Thomas Jefferson said a government big enough to give you everything is big enough to take away everything. That's Thomas Jefferson said that. I read it on the newspaper with them. But it says that if you fail to comply with this finance directive, we will direct the Justice Department to file suit and we'll cut off all funding from your school district. Then it says here, do not dare oppose the White House. Sincerely, President Barack Obama. That's extortion. He's trying to threaten you for. My God, where are we at in America? We're right there where Mordecai was. Hellish Haman was reigning and taking over there, and he was trying to hang the good people. There, look in your Bible. You got to read this. I tell you, it's all in there. You know, it's all in there. And I said that. What are you going to do? Go to church. How do you overcome? Hang a hammer. Go to church. Put a hand on her. And they said, stay faithful, even though the enemy seemed to be winning. And then notice this. Chapter 4, verse 16. What in the world, preacher? What are we going to do? Right before I read that, I'm going to show you what. Look at verse 8 of chapter 3 real quick before I go to chapter 4. Verse 8 of chapter 3. Here's a picture of a takeover like a Haman and a lion. Verse 8 of chapter 3. And Haman said unto King Ahasuerus, there is a certain people scattered abroad and dispersed among the people in all the provinces of thy kingdom. And their laws are diverse from all people. He said, this is a scattered group called the Jews, the Mormons. He said, their laws are so diverse and different from all people. There's a little group, and then that's the God's truth. The little group is scattered. That's where we're at. Hey, the church is scattered all to pieces. The Muslims pulling together, ISIS pulling together, we're pulling apart. He said that they're gathered in all provinces of thy kingdom, and their laws are diverse from all people, neither keep they the king's laws. Therefore, it is not for the king's prophet to suffer them. He said, King, said, they're going to hurt you, they're going to hit you. And that's what's happening today in America. Well, I went the other day to a Negro church on the road. I did. I said, y'all brothers, I trust y'all brothers. And I said, and Bob and me, and Matthew, I said, we're going to honor an old-time man of God tonight. So we're going to heaven and get you saved. We're blood-bought, born again. We love you, folks. Appreciate what you do. I thought at least one Negro would come. I invited a whole house to come. They had one of them come. Now I'm not against the Negroes. Could have been Spanish over. My point of the matter is, you know what? America is so divided. The president we got, the hang we got in the White House, is trying to cause this nation to divide with race. He's trying to divide us with race. He's trying to say the blacks against the whites, bring up race. I saw one of the stars that we're having a special on the news on the white and black race relations. No, it ain't. No, it ain't. Every one of them thinks the white man's against them, this, that, and the other. And all. Listen, I'm telling you, it ain't about race. It's about morality. That's right. I wish to God, man, I wouldn't care if it's a black man. A man, I wouldn't care if it's a Chinese in the White House. He had some morals. I wouldn't even ask him to be saved. Just have some morals. Look what it is. Verse number 9. If it please the king, let it be written that they may be destroyed. Verse 9. He said, King, this religious crowd, they're really going to hurt you. So if it's okay, king, I'm going to say, let them be destroyed. That they may be destroyed, and I will pay 10,000 pounds of silver to the hand of those that have the charge of business to bring it into the king's treasuries. He said, if you'll just let me kill them, all the money I'll make out of this, I will put it in your treasury. And friend, all of these super PAC powers, they're trying to get Hillary in the White House. That's what they do. They proctor and gather. They're full of devil worship. They're back in Hillary. I've been by the place that they started at. It's got all the devil symbols out there on the sign. Proctor and gather, don't they make palm olive? Solve your hands while you do the dishes. They make ivory soap. And they say this, ivory soap, 99 and 44, 100 is pure. Something like that. And you know what they're saying? They're making implication, comparing prices to the devil, all kind of things. Wait, but these super PACs are backing this. They want to get rid of the Christians. And they're going to allow ISIS to do it. If we was America like we're supposed to be, we'd have blue eyes and plumb. My God, we'd have a greasy spot in the road off the mouth. But see, that there's too much money funding out of Africa, out of Hawaii, out of all these Saudi Arabian countries over the Middle East. There's too much funding going on with the Haman that's in the White House. Y'all better pull me out if I go to jail. I'm telling you, that's what happened. Look at, y'all see this? If it please the king, let it be written that they may be destroyed. He wants to kill every Christian here. And I will pay 10,000 talents of silver to the hands of those that have the charge of the business to bring it into the king's treasuries. And the king took his ring from his hand and gave it to Haman, the son of Hammedatha and Agagite, and the Jews in him. Barack Obama, out of all the presidents, liberal or conservative we've had, he is the only one I know that's actually literally turned against Israel. He turned against Israel. He's the one. They hate the Jews, and they hate you. Now get this. Verse 7, the king said unto Haman, the city of the living today. Persecution's going to come. It's going to come to the church. It's going to come to our houses. Be prepared for it. Better hang before he hangs you. I beg you to God, if I could pay you, it's illegal to do this. If I could pay you $1 million a piece, I'd give it to you just to vote for somebody that ain't going to be a liberal like we got now. Notice what he do, how he hang Haman. Chapter 4, verse 16. Here you got Esther, a Jew, and Mordecai, a Jew. Looks like they're going to be defeated. But verse number 16, look what Mordecai and Esther came up with. Verse 15, then Esther bade them return Mordecai this answer. He said, Esther, you got to do something. She said, I know it, but I can't do it without you. I need you to help me. Yeah, so what happened, somebody in on the inside, and there's somebody, Mordecai, on the outside. Can I say, friend, we better band together today. I mean, honest to God, I'm telling you the truth. We need somebody on the inside that's going to be working for us. You better get somebody on the inside that will at least say they're Christian. I don't know if they don't behave, but this is deep stuff. So how to do that, verse 16, go gather together all the Jews that are present in Shushan, and fast ye for me, and neither eat nor drink 3 days not ordained. I also and my maidens will fast likewise, and so will I go in unto the king, which is not according to the law, and if I perish, I perish. So Mordecai went his way and did according to all that Esther had commanded him. How do you hang a hand before he hangs you? I tell you, fast and pray, and pray for one another. He said, if I die, I'll just die. Friend, I'd rather die doing right than live doing wrong. I'd rather, if my meal's going to fail tomorrow, I'd rather go out tonight doing right rather than live tomorrow and mess up real bad and do wrong. So how do you hang him? Then notice this, how do you hang him? Chapter 5, verse 9. Put another mark up there, man. You're about to get him hung here. A few more points. Now, chapter 5, verse number 9. How do you hang Haman before he hangs you? Look what it says. Then went Haman forth that day joyful with a glad heart, but when Haman saw Mordecai in the king's gate. Now look here. Mordecai has still stayed in the king's gate. He has no ability. It's out of his hands. He cannot progress any further, so he's going to pray for someone that God will put somebody in such leadership that they may advance the cause of Christ. He said he went there, and he came there to the gate, and Haman saw Mordecai the king, and the Mordecai Haman hated. Get this, that he stood not up nor moved for him. He was full of indignation against Mordecai. Here comes Haman, the leader, the second man in charge of all the provinces, 123. He walks over there to the gate, and there's old Haman. There's Mordecai. What's he do? He's down on his face. He's rent his clothes. He's in sackcloth and then burnt an offering and ashes at the gate. He didn't move. How do you, preacher, hang Haman before he hangs you? Stay on your knees. Stay on your knees. Lord, whoever pray, we're going to pray now. Hey, and he said he didn't move. Don't back up. Don't get up. Stay with God. Stay with God. Several times it mentions chapter 2, 19, chapter 4, verse 2, chapter 5, verse 9. All of them said, Mordecai sat in the king's gate. Right now, we're not in Washington, but we can stay on knees. We can make sacrifice. We're about to get him hung. Notice this. Chapter 5, verse 13. How can we hang before he hangs us? Chapter 13, verse 5. Yet all this availeth me nothing so long as I see Mordecai the Jew sitting at the king's gate. Haman began talking to his wife, Zeresh. And said, honey, said, you know, I know I'm the second man in charge. I should be happy. I got all this. Said, but I can't enjoy it because Haman's sitting there at the gate. I remember Mordecai's at the gate. Haman said, I can't enjoy where I've got, where the king's put, because Mordecai's sitting over at the gate. Can I say this? The way to hang a Haman before he hangs you, I tell you how to do it. Hey, get this. Hey, outlast your enemy. Exhaust him rather than him exhausting you. You know what did Mordecai do? He didn't do no physical battle, no fight. He just stayed at the gate. He stayed in his place. He stayed in his position. He stayed praying. He stayed faithful. He went to church. Someone said, rebuke the devil. He'll flee from you, all that. No, the Bible didn't say that. The Bible said, resist the devil. He'll flee from you. So resist the devil. Resist them. And notice how to hang him before he hangs you. Look in chapter 6, verse 1 through 3. On that night could not the king sleep. He commanded to bring the book of records of the Chronicles. And they were read before the king. And it was found written that Mordecai had told of Bigthana and Teresh, two of the king's chamberlains, the keepers of the door, who sought to lay hand on King Ahasuerus. Remember I told you about that a while ago? Mordecai said, King, they're about to kill you. And verse number 3, and the king said, what honor and dignity hath been done to Mordecai for this? Then said the king's servant that ministered unto him, there is nothing done for him. They hadn't done anything. They forgot about it. What do you see, preacher? How can I hang before he hangs me? I tell you how. Remember when it said in verse 1, and he commanded to bring the book of the records. Could I say the way to hang a hangman before he hangs you? Remember, God's got a record book. Yeah. When you've done wrong, remember, God's got a record book. Remind and remember that God has a record book. How can I hang Haman before he hangs me? Keep living in your memory that God is going to make it all right one day. God's got a record. God knows you've done right. He knows you've stayed faithful. God's got a record book. And then we're about to get him home now. Chapter 6, verse 3. The king said, what honor and dignity hath been done to Mordecai for this? Then the king's servants that ministered unto him, there is nothing done for him. How do you hang Haman? We're going to get a leg on a business here, and we'll put a foot on him and have him hung before he hangs you. He said, there's nothing been done for him. He was forgotten about it. For about 4 to 6 years, he was forgotten about it. So the way to hang Haman before he hangs you is this. Serve God though you're not recognized. Serve the Lord though you're not recognized. Well, no one said about me, I did this, I planted this, I did that, I picked up this trash, I did this, I marked the lines off, I cleaned the pews, I took out the trash. Listen, serve God without having to be recognized. And then you will watch God vindicate you and magnify and exalt you to a position of great. The Bible said that Mordecai, chapter 9:8-9, said this, and Mordecai waxed greater and greater than that. He waxed greater. The Bible said Jesus waxed strong. So what? He served God and wasn't recognized, but now he's being like Christ. And then let's put the foot on him and get him hung out. How? How in the world do I hang before he hangs me? You got to remind yourself of this one thing. Chapter 6, verse 6. So Haman came in. The king said, and what shall be done unto the man whom the king delighteth to honor? Now Haman thought he was talking about him. Remember I told you that. Now Haman thought into it in his heart, to whom would the king delight to do honor more than to myself? Listen, friend, I'm saying to you this. If you're going to hang Haman, you got to realize it ain't about you. It ain't about the same appointment. It ain't about you. It ain't about yourself. It's about Christ. Look at verse 7. There. And Haman answered the king, for the man whom the king delighted to honor. He said, here's what do, king. Let the royal apparel be brought which the king useth to wear. He said, put a robe on her like the king got. The Bible said this. They meant it for evil, but God meant it for what? Remember this. That principle still works. The enemies that hurt you for evil, but God meant it for good. Verse 3 said, let the royal apparel be brought which the king used to wear, and the horse of the king ride them on. Said, give him the king's horse. That's what Haman the wicked man said. How to hang Haman before he hangs you? Get this. Give him the king's horse, that the king ride them on, and the crown royal which is set upon his head. Actually, okay. And let this apparel and the horse be delivered to the hand of one of the king's most noble princes, that they may array the man with all whom the king allotted in honor, and bring him on horseback through the street of the city. I read about somebody else putting a robe on him, leading him through a city on a donkey. Mm-hmm. It's all been here, y'all. Through the street of the city, and proclaim before him, thus shall it be done to the man whom the king allotted in honor. Then the king said to Haman, make haste and take the apparel and the horse as thou hast said, and do even so to Mordecai the Jew that sitteth at the gate. Let nothing fail of all that thou hast spoken. He said, that same son you thought was going to you, you go give it to Mordecai. And it was that sitteth at the gate. Some people never receive what God has for them because they do not continue sitting in their place at the gate. Preacher, how can I hang before he hangs me? Man, he's going to put the foot on. I'll tell you this. Remind yourself there's a better day coming. It don't seem fair now. You're hurting. Remind yourself there's a better day coming. And that mindset, as a man thinking it's hard so easy, that mindset, that heart, that mindset, if we think like that, it will hang Haman because we'll have the right attitude. We'll see then that God's in control after all. Put the foot on him, he's hung. That's how you hang Haman before it hangs you. If you got jealousy in your heart, hang it or she'll hang you. No, preacher said, Brother Bill, we better hang together or else we'll hang separately. Never understood. It took me 3 years to understand that. My friends, we'll hang together or we'll hang separately. I said, what? What he meant was we better bond together in the church or else the devil will pinpoint and pull his sheep away from the flock and destroy he or she separately. A lion, when he attacks a herd of buffaloes or zebras, whatever, he goes after the weakest one. They try to stay together, and after a while, it's everybody for his own, and when they pull out, it leaves one hanging out there, and they're destroyed. Friend, if we ever stuck together, stick together now. The greatness of Southside Baptist Church will be displayed in our community as how we hang together when we build another addition. It will display to our community how we hang together Monday night with an unexpected revival with Dr. Larry Bradley be anywhere to come to preach it. Is in Yankton. I dare say to you, I bet you $5 to a donut hole. There won't be a visiting pastor in town or probably out of town to be here. Because there's too much jealousy all across this land. It's a shame. That's the way it is. All those scriptures I preached for gave my family's life on the road for. You get a pretty church, ain't gonna mess in no more. They cut out, but you know what? I wouldn't do it if it was starting. We're doing it for the Lord.
Amen.
And just stand together. Don't forget that. Hang before you hang Jesus. We stand together. Thank you, Matthew. God help us tonight, I pray. There's one needs to come. I pray, Holy Spirit of God, move on our hearts. Lord Jesus, we love you. We praise you. Give me glory. Lord, I'm not trying to be facetious or stubborn-willed or a nasty spirit, but Lord, we hate sin because I know what it did to me and what it'll do to our country and our church. So God help us be faithful and hang that Haman before it hangs us. Help us, Lord, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. If you need to come, the altar's open. What's hanging? Hang before he hangs you. One hangman game, get hung by doing wrong. This way we hang the enemy by doing right. By doing right. Hanging him. Things. Oh, I just love to.
morning. Appreciate you being here. Praise the Lord. And I'll be back Sunday morning, Sunday school 10, preach 11, 5 o'clock, you 6 o'clock, regular service. Keep all those things in mind, okay? Amen. All right, let's be in the word of prayer. We'll go our ways tonight. Pray for those that are sick and traveling tonight, those at home sick, those working tonight. Man, it's a busy time, man. And folks are busy working, won't be here. Some sick at home, won't be here. Some ain't feeling well. Some of the boss had a funeral for his dad on Saturday. We've got others that have engagements out of town and all that. So pray for them. God help them that's traveling back tomorrow and the next day on that, okay? All right, let's be dismissed in word of prayer. And Brother Danny Hawks, please dismiss us.
And the Father, Lord, save you in the house that we would honor you, Lord. We want to send over to this country, Lord.
Lord God.
May we do our part, Lord. We have prayer for the living room next to Lord. We need to fly out there. Right, someone in the valley is there, Lord. Lord, we want to thank you for you, Lord, for this country. So thank you for the past, Lord.
Amen. God bless you. Good night.